Welcome back! My name is ballerscuba. This is Video Games Over Time! We are still in 1983. Today, we're going to talk about the Famicom. The story of the Famicom takes us back to Nintendo. We have talked about Nintendo previously. On top of its own history video, we have talked about Nintendo in our videos on Donkey Kong and Donkey Kong Jr. We last talked about Nintendo in our video on Mario Brothers. For the Famicom, Nintendo turned to Masayuki Uemura. Uemura originally worked for the Sharp Corporation, selling photocell technology to several companies. One of those companies was Nintendo. Nintendo would hire Uemura in 1971. Gunpei Yokoi, Nintendo's lead designer, was very interested in the technology Uemura worked on, so Yokoi and Uemura worked together to create electronic light guns, including the laser clay shooting system in 1973, which we mentioned in our History of Nintendo video. Uemura succeeded within Nintendo and was given a lot of responsibility. When Nintendo's president Hiroshi Yamauchi split the company into different research and development departments, Masayuki Uemura was named the head of R&D 2. R&D 2's focus was on hardware. At the time, that meant developing the color TV game dedicated consoles, the most successful first generation consoles of all time. In November 1981, Yamauchi called Uemura and asked him to create a new console. This console's main goal was to be able to fully replicate Nintendo's newest hit arcade game, Donkey Kong, on a home console. Work began on this console in 1982. On top of being able to replicate Donkey Kong, Nintendo wanted the console to be able to outperform its competitors, a feat they wanted to keep for at least a year. As well as more powerful, Nintendo wanted the console to be more affordable than all of its competitors. Going under the codename Project Gamecom, Uemura started by looking at the rival consoles. In particular, Uemura looked at the Atari 2600 and the Magnavox Odyssey, but found them outdated. Uemura also looked at the Epoch Cassette Vision, the best-selling console at the time in Japan. However, engineer Katsuya Nakagawa concluded that the integrated circuits of Donkey Kong's arcade cabinet would be the best basis for the new console. Although the original plan for the controllers was to use joysticks, engineer Takao Sawano suggested that the new D-pad from the Game & Watch version of Donkey Kong be used for the console instead. The D-pad, short for directional pad, from the Game & Watch version of Donkey Kong is the invention of Gunpei Yokoi. To this point, the main method of directional control for console and arcade games has been the joystick. However, D-pads, especially the cross or plus design patented by Nintendo, allow for more precise control by the player while also being cheaper to manufacture and less prone to damage over time. In particular, Nintendo imagined children stepping on the controller and a potential joystick while it was on the floor. While Nintendo's console was still being developed, Coleco developed the ColecoVision. We previously talked about the ColecoVision in its own video. This new console made quite the impression on Nintendo's employees, but it was not as powerful as Nintendo would want their console to be. Coleco would earn the rights to release the first home console version of Donkey Kong for the ColecoVision, which would become a bestseller. Becoming more powerful than the ColecoVision became a priority for the new console. For their console, Uemura would send a couple engineers to Ricoh, a Japanese semiconductor manufacturer, to try and work out the hardware for the console. Ricoh had previously worked with Nintendo to help power Nintendo's arcade cabinets. Nintendo brought with them a Donkey Kong cabinet to analyze. the goal was still to make a console as powerful as the arcade cabinet. Uemura initially wanted to use a more powerful microprocessor, such as the Intel 8086 or Zilog Z8000 chips. These powerful chips, commonly known as 16-bit CPUs, have already been seen in some powerful computers and arcade cabinets of the time. However, Uemura switched to a modified version of the MOST Technology 6502 chip. This chip has been used quite often throughout the history of video games so far. We have seen versions of the 6502 chip used in the Commodore PET, Apple II, Commodore 64, and Atari computers, as well as both the Atari 2600 and Atari 5200 consoles. This specific variation of the MOST Technology 6502 chip was manufactured by Ricoh. Known as the Ricoh 2A07 or Ricoh 2A03 depending on the region, the chip was modified to be roughly 50% faster than the version used in the Atari 2600. The 2A07 was supplemented by a custom graphics chip, known as the Picture Processing Unit, which was also produced by Ricoh. As a result of the combination of these two chips, the console had a color palette of 48 colors and 6 different shades of gray. Up to 25 of those colors can be displayed at once, and up to 64 sprites can be displayed at once. The display resolution would be 256 by 240 pixels. The system would also support 5 different sound channels. While the plans for the console originally included a floppy disk drive, a keyboard, and a modem, the desire to keep the console inexpensive scrapped those plans. Instead, an expansion port was added to the console so that future peripherals could be attached later. Nintendo president Yamauchi also felt that those features would be intimidating to many potential customers. A prototype of the console was finished in October 1982 for testing. Because no hardware in Japan using the 6502 had been manufactured by this point, programming video games for the system proved to be difficult. Early games were designed on NEC PC-8001 computers because no software for programming for the system existed. Games for the console would be cartridge-based. Cartridges allow for fast loading, larger games, and room for additional processing power in the cartridge itself. These cartridges originally were supposed to be the size of a cassette, but became double the size of cassettes before the end. Nintendo paid special attention to the connections between cartridges and the console, as this was a typical issue in arcade cabinets. Uemura's wife is credited with naming the console. Seeing the console as neither a home computer or a personal computer, she suggested that the name be based on the term family computer. This would be shortened to Famicom. The color scheme was chosen by Nintendo president Yamauchi, who was influenced by a billboard for DX Antenna. They used a red and white color scheme for that ad, so the Famicom became a red and white console, intentionally making it look like a toy. Adding to the design, Gunpei Yokoi suggested the addition of an eject button. While unnecessary, Yokoi felt that children would be entertained by pressing the button. The Famicom would come with 2 controllers. The controllers would use the D-pad discussed earlier, as well as 4 buttons. They would be hardwired to the console itself for cost reasons. Uemura added a microphone to the second controller, thinking that a child could use the microphone to play their voice through the television speakers. Nintendo released the Famicom in Japan on July 15, 1983, officially named the home cassette type video game Family Computer. it sold for 14,800 yen, roughly $150 in 1983 and $435 in 2022. There were originally only three games available for the console. Those were Donkey Kong, Donkey Kong Jr., and Popeye. These were, of course, all ports of Nintendo arcade games. All three games were ported by Nintendo R&D 2, with Toshihiko Nakago as the lead programmer. The Famicom port of Donkey Kong does not include the cement factory stage or most of the cutscenes, but it does include a new song by Yukio Kaneoka. The Famicom was initially popular, selling 500,000 units in the first 2 months, despite only having three games initially. The Famicom would have nine games released for it by the end of 1983. We will talk about some of the important titles in our honorable mentions video at the end of the year. All nine of these games were developed and published by Nintendo. Things were looking good for the Famicom initially. However, many units had a faulty graphics chip. So, Nintendo voluntarily recalled all Famicom systems just before the holiday season. The Famicom was reissued with a new motherboard and became far more popular than it had been before the recall. The Famicom would become the best-selling console in Japan in 1984, selling over 2.5 million units. Because of the success of the console in Japan, it is no surprise that Nintendo tried almost immediately to sell the console in other regions. However, Nintendo's plan to release the Famicom outside of Japan would not come to fruition in 1983. We will have to return to the topic of the Famicom's international release in later videos. The Famicom would prove to be one of the best-selling and most influential consoles of all time. It is one of the first consoles to be considered a third-generation console. That means that the Famicom represents the first major step in console hardware since 1976, 7 years earlier. We will feature the history of the Famicom and its games in several videos as we continue. We, of course, will continue to talk about Nintendo in the future as well. We will also hear from Hiroshi Yamauchi, Masayuki Uemura, Gunpei Yokoi, and Takao Sawano again as well. All of them would continue to work at Nintendo and continue to make an impact in the video game industry. That will do it for the story of the Famicom for now. My name is Baller Scuba. This has been Video Games Over Time. Thank you so much for watching, and I hope to see you in our next video when we blow things away.